Welcome to all of those of you here in New York and those of you participating via live webcast in other areas across the country. Cheryl Crispin, Executive Vice President for Communications with SIFMA. Today we are joined by four of our industry experts, Jerry Del Messier, who is Co-Chief Executive, Barclays Capital, Tim Ryan, and also Chairman of SIFMA, Tim Ryan, President and CEO of SIFMA, Ken Bentsen, Executive Vice President of Public Policy and Advocacy at SIFMA, and Randy Snook, Executive Vice President of Business Practices at SIFMA. What we will be doing today is each of our participants will be making brief comments on a variety of topics as related to the 2000-year financial services industry priorities, and then we will be taking questions at the end.
I thought I'd just set the stage a little bit at a high level and before turning it back to Tim. And it's pretty clear to everybody, I think, that we're coming into 2012 really with a almost an unprecedented degree of layers of uncertainty around the economy, around our industry. We have in Europe I think probably the single biggest macro factor that will was certainly dominant in 2011 will continue, I think, to be the single biggest issue that we face in 2012. On top of that, I think we've had a period of economic weakness in the global economy that, while it feels certainly like it's receding here in the U.S., the issues in Europe, I think, will create some challenges for the European economies, and even some of the high-growth economies have slowed down. While it's unlikely that we'll see a return to global recession, at best, what I think this characterizes or what this underscores is that we are in a period of uneven economic recovery as we work through the challenges that we've been dealing with the last couple of years. And if I, come back to Europe, we've seen a better start to 2012, which I think is reflective of, on the one hand, probably excess pessimism in the third and fourth quarters of last year about the prospects for Europe and the European sovereign debt markets. I think it's a reflection of the cumulative effect of some of the things that had been put in place late in the year. We probably underestimated as a market the impact that the ECB's long-term financing operations have had, and I think you're starting to see that play itself out in a return to a more stable environment for the sovereign debt markets. And with that as a foundation, I think we can probably see better conditions this year, allowing for some of the longer-term measures to take hold, and that's the deleveraging of the financial system in Europe, recapitalization of the banks, and ultimately some of the measures of fiscal consolidation that the states need to implement on a more longer-term basis to A, get control of their budget deficits in the near and medium term, and more importantly, some of the structural shifts that will go a long way towards improving European competitiveness. I mean, this is a long process. I don't think we should be expecting, a sort of any silver bullets. It's a process that is fraught with risk, and I think we need to be prepared to accept event risk and volatility as really key features of these markets going forward, and because of the political nature of some of the decisions that need to be taken, this will play itself out over a long period of time. So, I don't think we're certain, anywhere near declaring victory, but I think it would be our view certainly that the chance of a breakup is remains a very, very remote possibility. As if the European situation and the challenging economic environment weren't enough, I mean, we also have a significant agenda of change on the regulatory front. European banks have implemented Basel 2.5. We're looking forward over the next couple of years to an implementation of a broader set of capital reforms that will change the very structure of the banking industry. And then on top of that, we have reforms and new regulations that will change the very structure of the markets that we operate in, and certainly here in the U.S., the promulgation of Dodd-Frank related rules will be a major issue that we will have to deal with. And
very briefly, I'm going to talk about the year that's just finished and give you some sense of what we anticipate for the year going forward. I'm going to turn it to Randy Snook to talk in some detail about one issue which is taking up an awful lot of our time, which is implementation of the Volcker Rule in Dodd-Frank. And I'm going to ask Ken to give you some sense of what's going on from a legislative standpoint, so from a deeply Washington standpoint. So as Jerry said, I would say 11, I view, is kind of the real beginning of implementation for financial regulatory reform. Both in the U.S. and in Europe, in U.S. driven principally by Dodd-Frank, in Europe driven by the activities in Brussels, the activities in Basel, and the activities emanating out of the U.K. government, so things like the Vickers Report, all of which are all going in pretty much the same type direction. There are nuances, but That's the start of the implementation. It's not complete. In fact, in all of the areas I just mentioned, there's still work in progress. We at SIFMA and our colleagues in London and Brussels, which is AFME, have been working closely with all of our members, which is basically everybody in the markets business, to try to get the rules done in a responsible, reasonable, and effective fashion. So we think we've been active and positive participants. Just in the U.S., we've filed, I think, last count, over 220 comments on Dodd-Frank. We've been doing the same thing with the BIS and with the FSB, with the European Commission, and with the U.K. government. So that's kind of 11 was kind of the start. Or as I like to call it, the beginning of the end from the regulatory reform standpoint. We've identified some areas where, unfortunately, governments have not met our test. And we can talk about that in a lot more comprehensive fashion. But the best example, which is now unfortunately resulted in litigation, is the lawsuit that ISDA and SIFMA have brought against the CFTC in the federal courts in the District of Columbia, challenging the position limit rules out of the CFTC. And you know, it's our hope that litigation is for us, it's a last step. It's not something we want to do. That's not our plan. Our plan is to be a responsible participant in regulatory development through the comment process and through just discussion and debate with governments. So going into 12, we as Jerry said, we have, I would say in 11 we were not anticipating the financial situation in Europe that exists today. So we are once again not only addressing regulatory reform implementation issues, but we're doing it in a challenging economic environment. We were hoping that would not be the case. We were hoping we would just be looking at the regulatory reform piece. But I view 2012 as kind of finalizing implementation. We're about, in the U.S., about a quarter finished with Dodd-Frank. We're in a very fast track right now, so we should be seeing really substantive rules coming out over the next 6 months, which we can then put in place in the industry and start adapting. The industry, and I'll just talk for U.S. here for a minute, the industry is in financially much better shape than it was at the beginning of the financial crisis. You've heard this from me before. Capital is way up. Leverage is way down. Provisioning is way up. Generally, the industry is in pretty good shape. It's finding adapting to the new financial environment more difficult, especially in the markets businesses, because we don't know the answers to many of the questions still.
I want to just hit on a few major topics that are top of mind for us, concern for our members, and we think very tied in with the functioning of the markets, credit availability, and the economy largely. But the first one we want to touch on is the Volcker Rule. This is something for us, our members, is taking a lot of our time. Our principal concern with the rule is it's got the potential to adversely and negatively impact the functioning of the markets. The Volcker Rule is a rule that seeks to prohibit proprietary trading while permit certain activities. And our concern with the way the rule is constructed is that in the market making and customer related functions, that those activities are potentially going to be defined so narrowly as to limit and hurt normal market making and customary liquidity provisioning and providing that you would see in the markets. And that's got the potential to most adversely impact things like the corporate bond and credit markets, the private market for mortgage-backed securities, and derivative markets, among others. So that's an area where we're spending time. We're being very comprehensive in trying to provide input to the regulatory bodies that are working on this rule. I think we realize that it's a challenging rule on the one hand. On the other, we think it's critically important that this rule gets written and implemented in a way that doesn't hurt the markets. And as we think about this rule, I think it's worth remembering and telling that the government itself, in constructing the rule, accepted certain markets from this prohibition. So it said that the Treasury market in the U.S., the bonds of the U.S. GSEs, Freddie and Fannie, and municipal bonds are exempted from the rule. And in our mind, that's a recognition that those markets and the functioning of those markets and the liquidity in those markets would have been hurt. And what that would have meant is a higher cost of funds for those securities or issuance in those markets. As part of the process, we've tried to provide some economic support. We've worked with Oliver Wyman on a study to really further dimension the potential cost. And as part of that study, Oliver Wyman looked at the corporate market for both investment grade and high yield bonds. In the last several years, there's been approximately $1 trillion each year issued in those markets. And the Oliver Wyman study showed that there's a potential cost consequence for issuance of an additional $12 to $43 billion annually. The other areas that I would touch on today in this really opening comment that we'll make here with you today are two other areas I want to just speak to directly right now. One is the equity market. While much of the equity market is outside of the purview, if you look at the Dodd-Frank rulemaking, it's the equity market and equity market structure is not largely a part of it, but there are a lot of things happening within the equity markets and the regulation of the equity markets, and we're focused on that area. We think it's very tied in with trust and confidence. We have been very supportive of some of the recent regulation to limit or curtail excess volatility, things like the single stock circuit breaker we've been very supportive of, things like the new proposed rule that would be a modification of that. It's called limit up, limit down. That's something we've been very supportive of. In addition to improvements and what are called the market-wide circuit breakers. And then in addition, we've been supportive of the and we're now implementing something that's called the large trader reporting rule. And there's another rule proposal called the consolidated audit trail. We have some debate on that one, and the spirit of that we're supportive of. There's a distinction. I'd say we're not supportive of that being implemented on a real-time basis, but we are supportive of the rule. I mention those two rules because those will give regulators even better tools to understand and surveil what's happening in the equity market and what's happening with different market participants in terms of trading activity and trading flows. The last point I think I'll touch on today is something called the legal entity identifier. And this is more of an operations and technology kind of issue, but it's important, and it's important for the systemic risk, and it's important for regulators trying to better measure and manage systemic risk. And so what SIFMA has been doing in this area has been encouraging a standard. We call it the legal entity identifier, but basically what that says is, and what that would provide, is a common way for financial institutions to identify counterparties throughout the U.S. and, in fact, throughout the world, and that would give regulators a better way to see risk, better ways to aggregate risk, and have a common framework for understanding either concentrated risk, changes in risk, or things that might be concerning in volatile markets.
A couple of points on the legislative regulatory aspect from the Washington perspective. As Tim mentioned, in terms of Dodd-Frank, we're about 22 to 23% through the mandated rules, with about 40% of rules proposed and another 40% needed to be proposed. So we still have quite a bit of Dodd-Frank in front of us, but as Tim mentioned, there'll be a lot coming out this year, we expect. In terms of deadlines, we know that you know, only about 25% of deadlines have been made, but I think that the regulators are getting signals from Congress and certainly from the industry that we would prefer them to take the time necessary to get the rules done right as opposed to doing them rapidly and having to go back and do them again. In addition to, Randy mentioned Volcker, the other major rules we'll be looking at coming out will be non-bank SIFI designation, the Section 165 enhanced prudential standards, that both those rules are sitting out proposed right now. A number of Title VII rules still left to be done, risk retention, and then, of course, the Uniform Fiduciary Standard, Section 913, for personalized investment advice, which lays out there at this point in time, yet to be proposed. From a legislative perspective, we continue to see Congress exercise its oversight authority looking at Dodd-Frank, which we think is entirely appropriate and a responsibility of Congress. And we have seen some legislation push, particularly in the Title VII derivatives area in the House, both in the House Financial Services Committee, which has produced three bills so far, and the House Agriculture Committee, which will be marking up some bills that we understand next week. I think it's likely we'll see some of these bills move out of the House, but I'm less optimistic that we would see much of anything move out of the Senate, Dodd-Frank or not. I think overall Congress this year is only going to produce a few items in the budget and tax area, but just given the political nature of things, I don't think we're going to see a lot of product, and I don't think we're going to see really much, if anything, other than oversight with respect to Dodd-Frank. I think it is possible that we'll see perhaps some small bore capital formation bills dealing with Reg D, C-Corps, or S-Corps, and possibly small issue IPOs where there's some pretty strong bipartisan support. And I think we will also see further movement on Chairman Baucus's of the House Financial Services Committee's SRO bill for registered investment advisors. As you know, there's a draft bill out there. It's received a lot of comments. The chairman is supposed to be producing a second draft, and we could see committee action on that. In addition, there's a lot in the non-Dodd-Frank space. There have been a number of hearings and some discussion on GSE reform bills or housing finance reform bills. We're not expecting to see a final action in this Congress, but we do think there'll be continued discussion, which is appropriate, as Congress works to try and find a solution to the GSE situation. I'll go to taxes in a second, but sort of in the non-legislative, but where Congress has an interest. In the SEC side, Randy mentioned consolidated audit trail, which is something we're watching very closely that could come out soon. As you know, Chairman Shapiro has mentioned coming out with a revised or an additional money market funds proposal. That's something that we're watching possibly affecting the NAV that we're very concerned about, the industry's very concerned about, so that's something that we'll watch. We don't expect at this point in time any action on 12B1s. There is a proposal sitting out there that's been there for quite a while, but the sense is that until Section 913 Uniform Fiduciary Duties done, 12B1 won't be done. In the case of the Department of Labor and their proposed ERISA fiduciary rule, which was withdrawn to be reproposed, we expect that to be reproposed by the department sometime in the first 6 months of the year. They're in the process of undertaking a long overdue and appropriate cost-benefit analysis, as well as we understand preparing proposed prohibited transaction exemptions that would be included with that rule. So we'll be watching that very closely as well. On tax, we don't expect much on the tax side this year, other than the payroll tax extension, and hopefully dealing with other extender items, including active financing. That is important to a number of our member firms. We think there'll be continued discussion on corporate tax reform, including Chairman Camp's proposed territorial tax regime, which we think is very important. And we do have the Bush tax cuts that lay out there for expiration at the end of the year, and we continue to advocate for a permanent extension of the preferential capital gains and dividends tax rates linked. Which there is actually bipartisan support, including from the Obama administration, but we're not certain that we'll see action on that before the November elections. We certainly would like to, but it could be that could be another lame duck issue that's dealt with as well. Just briefly on the international front, and Tim talked about this quite a bit, but one issue in particular, in addition to the capital issues that we're watching, is discussion about a financial transaction tax. As you know, there's a lot of there's been a lot of call for that, particularly among France and Germany and other parts of the Eurozone. There continues to be strong opposition in the Congress to that, even though there has been a bill introduced, as well as strong opposition around the globe, and we remain strongly opposed to that. We don't see that happening in the U.S., but we're watching it very closely. And I just close in saying that in the states level, we have many state legislatures now back in session. States are still grappling with fiscal problems, so we'll be looking at tax issues there.